All right, if you guys want to start making it back to your seats, please. All right, we're going to start with number 28, All for a Thousand Tongues. So number 28 on the red hymnal, All for a Thousand Tongues. They asked me to just remind everyone that it's going to be slick. Typical Missouri, it's ice, not snow or rain. So just watch out as you walk out there, as you go home. If you need a place to stay again, just let Isaac know or one of us and we can find a place. A little just reminder of the rest of the schedule for today. We're going to have another ministry session right now and then a little 10 minute break. Another session and then dinner. And then after dinner, another session and then some corporate prayer. So that's kind of like the schedule for the rest of today. Other than that, if you need coffee or anything like that, there's more downstairs. So feel free to get some of that. Let's also sing number 30, Behold What Love, number 30.
Thank you.
right, thank you for your singing. Brother Mike, I'm ready for you.
All right, good afternoon again. Number three session out of five today. So you are wearing well, well done. And let's hope the Lord will continue to give us grace as we continue this study of the person and work of the Holy Spirit, the neglected person of the Godhead. And please turn with me again to John chapter 7. I want to read those verses. I want them to be so familiar to us by the days out. It says, in the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture hath said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. But this spake he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because that Jesus was not yet glorified. And then maybe one other scripture we would look at before we launch into the passage, the study, Matthew's Gospel, chapter 3, please. Matthew 3 and verse 11. Matthew 3, verse 11 says this, I indeed baptize you with water. This is John the Baptizer speaking, unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. And God will add a blessing to the reading of his precious word. So just to remind ourselves where we've come, and then we'll look at where we're going. We've thought about the Holy Spirit, his significance, that he's a real person, that he's a divine person, and that he lives within us. If we're believers, our body is indeed the temple of the Holy Spirit. And tragically, as well as being a divine person and a real person, he sadly, for much of our experience as believers, has been a neglected person. We probably haven't paid enough attention to our indwelling heavenly guest than we ought. And then we saw his ministry in the salvation of sinners, his work in the salvation of sinners. And now I want to think in this session about his security, the Holy Spirit and the believer's security, that not only are we saved, but we're securely saved. That's good, isn't it? That if you're really saved, you're not going to get lost again. You're saved for eternity. And he has a role in that, assuring us of our security in Christ. And then the session after that, we will look at his ministry in the believer's sanctification. How does he make us more holy? How does he make us more Christ-like? And then we'll think about his work in the believer's service. That will be our last session today. And then, Lord willing, tomorrow we're going to look at his symbols. So there are certain symbols that speak of the Holy Spirit, like oil and fire and wind. And we want to look at those symbols. And then it will be 12:15 lunch and we'll be done. So that's where we're headed. Sometimes good to know where we've been and also where we're going. So that's the plan. So I want to think about what is primarily in this session, positional truth. In other words, these things are real. They happened the day that you got saved, and they're unchangeable. It's how God views you, how he sees you. It's what we call our position in Christ, positional truth. And positional truth is very important truth. And so that's what we're going to be thinking of. And we want to begin thinking about what we call the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We read that verse in Matthew 3 about the Lord Jesus, that he's greater than John, and when he comes, he'll baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. So we want to think about, what does that mean? What does it mean to have this baptism of the Holy Spirit? And then what does it mean, this baptism of fire? Those are important questions. And they're questions that have caused a lot of confusion among the people of God. Okay, some people will say to you, you're saved, and they'll say, well, have you had the baptism of the Holy Spirit? as if it's some thing that happens subsequent to your conversion, like a second work of grace. The first work was you got saved, and then you have this second work called the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And so that certainly caused confusion. And part of the reason for the confusion has been the experience of men. And sometimes we've got to make sure that we get our doctrine from Scripture and not from the experience of men. And so, and I'm talking about good men. So men like D.L. Moody, he had an encounter with the Holy Spirit. The story is well known. There were two ladies, and whenever Moody was preaching, they would sit in the congregation, and it was obvious they were praying. And so he went up to these ladies, and he thanked them for their prayers. And they said, we're praying that you will have an experience of the Holy Spirit, a baptism of power. And D.L. Moody urged them to pray for the lost, not to pray for him, pray for the lost. And they said, no, we're praying that you will have a baptism of the Holy Spirit. And he was thankful that they did. Eventually, it kind of worked on his mind, they really prayed. They prayed with him and prayed for him that he would have this experience. And one day he was walking in New York, in Fulton Street, New York, and the presence of God became very real to D.L. Moody, more real than it had ever been, so real that he locked himself in a room because it was such a personal thing, and he felt that he was literally being overwhelmed with the love of God. It was kind of coming over him in waves, and he actually felt like he was being consumed with divine love. And he actually had asked God to stay his hand because he thought he'd be consumed. And he said, I went back to preaching. He said, I preached the same sermons, but with new power. He said, every time I preach, people will get saved. Now, whatever he got, I would love that, wouldn't you? I mean, preach the same sermons, new power. Every time you preach, somebody gets saved. I mean, sign me up. Whatever he got, that's what I want. And he termed it the baptism of the Holy Spirit. R.A. Torrey had a similar experience. Douglas Brown, Jock Troop, I could go through a lot of men. Billy Graham, he had what he called a baptism of the Holy Spirit in Wales. He was actually visiting a Welsh evangelist. And people heard him preach before, and they heard him preach after, and they said there was a difference. So that's caused confusion. And we want to think about maybe what happened to these men in a while. We want to consider that. But that has caused confusion concerning this. So we've got to, again, go to the Scriptures and try to determine what really is this baptism of the Holy Spirit. Now, what we do know is that it wasn't mentioned in the Old Testament. It's really not until John says, there's one coming after me, I baptize you with water, he will baptize you with the Holy Ghost. And so it's not something you find in the Old Testament. Now, in the Old Testament, we have to say that there were verses that caused people to expect something special regarding the work of the Holy Spirit connected with the new covenant. Okay, so there was an expectation in the Old Testament. So let's just look at some of those references for a minute. Look at the book of Ezekiel to think about expectations of this work of the Holy Spirit that is promised in connection with new covenant days. And so we'll look at Ezekiel 36. We'll break in verse 24. It says, for I will take you, speaking of Israel, I'll take you from among the heathen and gather you out of all countries and will bring you into your own land. Then I will sprinkle clean water upon you, and you shall be clean from all your filthiness, and from all your idols will I cleanse you. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I'll take away the stony heart of your flesh, and I'll give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. You shall keep my judgments and do them. So there's this expectation in the Old Testament that God is going to do something different to them, going to give them a new heart. He's going to put his spirit within them. Isaiah 32, just these Old Testament anticipations of this special day that is coming. Isaiah 32, verse 15, he says, until the Spirit be poured upon us from on high, and the wilderness be a fruitful field, and the fruitful field be counted for a forest. And again, isn't that beautiful language? It's talking of a scene of barrenness, and the Spirit will be poured upon us from on high, and the wilderness will become a fruitful field. And so, you know, these kind of messianic expectation type scriptures, Isaiah 44, verse 3, there was this expectation. Something was coming, and it was connected to the Holy Spirit, and it was going to turn barrenness into fruitfulness. For I will pour water upon him that is thirsty. Remember Jesus saying, is anyone thirsty? And floods upon the dry ground. I will pour my spirit upon thy seed, and my blessing upon thine offspring. So clearly, there is this expectation, and it seems to be connected with the coming of the new covenant, that there was this day coming. Now, we've already seen that when John spoke, the baptizer in Matthew's gospel, it hadn't happened then, this, what he describes as this baptism of the Holy Spirit, Matthew 3. He says, I indeed baptize you with water to repentance. That was happening at that moment. Some of them had already experienced that baptism of water to repentance. But he that comes after me is mightier than me, whose shoes I'm not worthy to bear. He will baptize you with the Holy Ghost. So it hadn't happened in Matthew chapter 3. It's not happened yet, but it's coming. And there's this expectation. Even Jesus' words, is anyone thirsty? Remember our key verse. And he tells us that the giving of the Spirit out of his innermost being will flow rivers of living water. This spake of his Spirit, which would come when? When Jesus was glorified. It hadn't happened yet because Jesus was not yet glorified. So it seems that this baptism of the Spirit, whatever it is going to happen after Jesus is glorified. That seems to be the key factor. So let's go back to Matthew 3, and I want to, first of all, get out of the way the baptism of fire part, because that's an interesting part, but he says he'll baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. And some of our dear Pentecostal brethren, and they are brethren, we love them, we're thankful for them, they will tell you that there is such a thing as a baptism of fire. And what that baptism of fire does, because fire speaks of consuming judgment, right? Our God is a consuming fire, that when you have the baptism of fire, it burns up your old nature. And you don't have a problem with it anymore. Now again, if you could wish that a false theology was true, I would love my old nature to be burned up. Wouldn't you? I mean, don't you get weary with it? It's coming, but not yet. Hadn't happened yet, right? But some of them think that it's happened. Now let's look at it in the context here of Matthew 3, because I want to suggest to you that the baptism of fire that he's speaking of is a baptism of judgment, but it's not judging our old nature, it's judging those that are not believers and burning them up. And so, as we look at this in the context, first of all, I want us to see who is being addressed in this passage. And I want to suggest to you that John is speaking to a mixed multitude, okay? So some of the hearers are those that have come, have heard John's preaching, his message of repent, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. They have believed his preaching, and his job was to the way, as it were, to make his path straight. And so these people had repented of their sins in anticipation of the coming of the Messiah, and they had been baptized by John in the Jordan River. But there were others that did not submit to John's baptism. So look at verse 5. It says, "Then went out to him Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region round about Jordan, and were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins." Now, by the way, isn't John's ministry absolutely remarkable? But where's he doing the preaching? He's in the wilderness, right? A man preaching in the wilderness. A strange man, like he's wearing strange garments and he's eating a strange diet. I mean, we'd say he's an oddball character, right? And yet, the whole city and region go out to hear him. Wow, that's something, isn't it? Remember, he was somebody that was filled with the Holy Spirit from his mother's womb. You remember that? Wow, what a preacher. He's not even in a convenient neighborhood or location, but droves are going out to hear him. But then it says, verse 7, so there's those that went out from all Jerusalem and Judea, the region around about Jordan, and were baptized by him. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees come to his baptism, he said unto them, "O generation of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? But bring forth therefore fruits meet for repentance." So there's one group that's clearly repenting, confessing their sins. There's another group, a religious group, and he calls them, "You're a bunch of snakes." I mean, can you imagine? That's kind of pretty direct preaching, isn't it? You're a bunch of snakes. And he says, "Bring forth fruit worthy of repentance." In other words, there's no evidence in your lives that you've repented at all. Bring it forth. It's not there to be seen. You got religion by the bucket load, but you don't have any repentance in your life. It's not there. And so then he says in verse 9, "And think not to say within yourselves, we have Abraham as our father, for I say to you that God is able of these stones to raise up children to Abraham. And now also the axe is laid to the root of the trees. Therefore, every tree that brings not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire." Okay? In other words, if there's no fruit, cut down, thrown in the fire. It tells them, bring forth fruit. There's no fruit in your life. Then in verse 12, speaking of this baptism of fire, he says, "Whose fan is in his hand, he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner, but he'll burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire." And so what he's saying is, yeah, there's going to be two baptisms. There's a baptism of the Holy Spirit. Those that respond to John's baptism, ultimately when Jesus comes and is glorified, those that have repented will receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Those that are unrepentant and bring forth no fruit, when he purges the floor, they're the chaff. And what's going to happen to them? They're going to be burnt up. It's a baptism of judgment. And it's a baptism of judgment that comes on the unrepentant who have not responded to John's ministry, nor will they respond to Jesus' ministry. So what do they have to look forward to? They'll burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. So I definitely do not want that baptism of fire, and I'm not going to get it either, because I did repent and believe the gospel. Okay? Instead, I have a different baptism, the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So, again, what is this baptism of the Holy Spirit? Look at Acts chapter 1 now and verse 5. Acts 1, verse 5. It says, "For John truly baptized with water," this is Jesus speaking to his disciples, But you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. So he's saying it's not going to be long until this event happens. Hasn't happened yet, but it's coming really soon. And notice he doesn't say you'll be baptized with the Holy Ghost and fire. That's not mentioned. He just said you're going to be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days now. So he didn't quote all of what John says. He ignores the idea of the baptism of fire because that's a baptism of judgment. It's yet to come for the godless world that didn't repent, did not believe the gospel. We'll see that in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. Let me just read to you from 2 Thessalonians 1 verse 8 when they will receive this fire baptism. It says in 2 Thessalonians 1 verse 8, it says verse 7, and to you who are troubled, rest with us when the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's the baptism of fire that is coming to the unbelieving, Christ-rejecting world. So, what is now this baptism of fire? Well, we said it hasn't happened yet in Acts 1, verse 5. But when we get to Acts 11, just turn to Acts chapter 11. Peter says this in verse 15, Acts 11, verse 15. And as I began to speak, the Holy Ghost fell on them. That's Cornelius and his household, as on us at the beginning. Then remembered I the word of the Lord, how that he said, John indeed baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost. So he says what had happened to Cornelius and his household. They obviously had been baptized with the Holy Ghost because it was just like the same thing that happened to us at the beginning. So what is the same thing that happened to them at the beginning? Well, it's what happened in Acts chapter 2, right? It hadn't happened in chapter 1, verse 5. Get to chapter 11. Same things happened to them that happened to us at the beginning. So what happened between chapter 1 and chapter 11? Well, chapter 2 certainly happened. And chapter 2 was that day when they were baptized with the Holy Spirit. So what does that look like, and what does it mean? I want to just mention something that maybe I should have mentioned earlier before we actually look at chapter 2, and that is, what's the difference between baptism and filling? Because we are told that we have been baptized, we'll see that, in the Holy Spirit. But we're told to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Okay? So we're not told to be, we're told that we already have been baptized, it's something that's happened, but we're told to be filled. So baptism and filling, far from being synonymous, they actually mean the opposite. So in baptism, we are put into the element, right? So when you were baptized, what happened? You were put into the water. So baptism is to put into something. Filling is something being put into you. The element is going into you, right? So when you're filled, something's going into you. So if you're filling a pitcher, something's going in there. Baptized, you're putting something into it, right? Do you see that distinction? I know it's been a long day, but I'm sure you can see the distinction. Good. I'm glad you can see the distinction. Very important distinction to see. So, Acts chapter 2. Very key passage that we have to consider. So it says, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, or we might say literally fulfilled. back in the book of Leviticus, and we don't have time to really look at Leviticus 23, but Pentecost was a feast day called the Feast of Weeks. And on that feast day, the Jews had to offer up two loaves, and it was called a new meal offering. Now, there's an original meal offering back in Leviticus chapter 2, which is a picture of Christ. And there's no leaven, it's fine flour, all the rest of it. This offering that was to be offered on the Feast of Weeks, there were to be two loaves, and they were baked with leaven. Fine flour, but leaven was in them, yeast, okay? No yeast in the first one, but there's yeast in the second one. And it was called a new meal offering. There were two loaves, but it was one offering. And so he's saying that whatever that foreshadowed back in Leviticus, it was literally being fulfilled on the day of Pentecost. And if we can, we're just going to give you the quick cliff notes here without going into a lot of details. But I believe that what happened on the day of Pentecost is that something new happened that never happened before. God took two separate things, Jews and Gentiles, and he baptized them into one new man, the church, right? It was the beginning of the church, the birthday of the church, where two separate groups became one. And the picture's beautiful because this fine flour, it speaks of Christ, because he's the only person that doesn't have any rough edges. You know, his that fine flour, there was no lumps or any coarseness in it. It was fine flour. And so every one of us, if you get to know us well enough, it won't be long before you see the rough edges, right? We're all sinners saved by grace. And the Lord had pretty poor material to start with, and he's been working away at us, but there's still some rough edges there in all of us. In Christ, there's none. But when we look at the church, you're still reminded of Christ in the church. There's something of Christ in every saint. We see something of him, right? We should. It's lovely when you see that. But there's leaven there. Leaven is a picture of evil in its permeating character. There's still sin in the church, right? Is there still sin in Jefferson City Bible Chapel? Sure, in every saint, isn't there? Still sin in the church. Now, it's not what it used to be, right? Because when you bake leaven, it arrests its power. It doesn't blow up quite as much, right? It's already done. So it's there, but it's arrested in its power, and it's still there. And so the church reminds us of Christ, but there's sin in the church. It's not perfect, not yet. In a coming day, he's going to present himself a beautiful bride without spot or wrinkle or any such thing. But right now, there's a few spots and wrinkles, right? But there's something of Christ too. So it's a beautiful picture. And so he says, now it's fully come. That day is fully come. And so what happened on that day? We're just going to look at some of the wonderful things, and then we'll get back to the wider topic. So it says, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. So we could say that the house is completely filled, and if the house is completely filled with this rushing mighty wind, it means they were immersed, right, in that rushing mighty wind. They were baptized in the Spirit that day, right? Because he's filling the whole house, and they're in the house like a rushing mighty wind. So they're definitely baptized in the Spirit in that day in a very remarkable way. And so then it says, there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. Well, isn't that the baptism of fire? Well, no, not exactly. You see, not only does fire symbolize the consuming power of God, right? Our God is a consuming fire. But it also symbolizes the presence of God, right? So if you saw the tabernacle, in the wilderness and you wondered to yourself, is God at home today? If it was in the daytime, how would you know he was there? Well, there'd be a cloud, wouldn't there? If it was in the nighttime, well, I wonder, has God gone out tonight or is he at home? How would you know he was there? Well, there'd be a pillar of fire over the tabernacle, wasn't there? So when these believers in that upper room look at each other, what do they see? In each one of them, there's a little tongue like as of fire on top of their heads. Now, the interesting thing is the only one that they couldn't see was their own. But they could see everybody else's. And what does that speak to these Jewish men? What is it telling them? Well, I think it's telling them a very important message. God has found himself a new dwelling place. He used to live in the tabernacle in the wilderness. That was his home. But now he's got a new home. What is that new home? It's the believers, right? God is resident now in them. By the way, I often say this, but I would love it if I was in a meeting and just for a minute, God would do that. Because, you know, I wouldn't be looking for the ones that had the flame. I'd be looking for the ones that didn't have the flame. And I'd say, I'm going to give that guy a personal gospel message because he's not saved. He doesn't have the presence of God in him. The fire's not there. So he'd get a very personalized gospel message. It would morph into a gospel message for that individual. But God doesn't do that. He did it once. Now, in the New Testament age, we're not going. Remember, most of these in this upper room, they're Jews anyway. And Jews require a sign telling them, I'm doing something new. We take it by faith, based on the word of God. So, what about the New Testament now in terms of the epistles? Because you all know the formula that usually some truth is predicted in the Gospels. So we saw that in Matthew's Gospel chapter 3. And then it's experienced in the Acts. And we see this in Acts chapter 2. And then it's usually explained in the epistles. Okay, and that's a good way of looking at things. Usually things are predicted in the Gospels, experienced or practiced in the Acts, and explained in the epistles. And it's to the epistles that we need to go to get our explanation. So let's go to 1 Corinthians 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And verse 13. Paul says this, for by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body. Whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, we have all been made to drink into one Spirit. But we said baptism is the idea of to immerse, to place into something. And so at conversion, we were placed into that one body of Christ by the Holy Spirit, right? You became part of the body the day you were saved. Now, it's interesting. He says this to the Corinthians. Most of them were not there present on the day of Pentecost, right? Because the gospel hadn't come to Corinth yet. But the day they trusted Christ, they came into the good of what happened on the day of Pentecost. Just as I wasn't born when Jesus died on Calvary, but the day that I was saved, I came into all the good of what took place on that day, right? And in the very same way, the day that I was saved, I came into all the good of what took place at Pentecost. And so he's saying to these Corinthians, by one Spirit, are we all baptized, placed into, put into, immersed into that one body, Whatever our ethnic background, whether we're Jews or Gentiles, whether we're bond or free, we've all been made to drink into one spirit. So there's two things going on here. On the one hand, the Spirit of God placed us into the one body at conversion, and then we've all been made to drink of that one spirit. And so when you drink something, what happens? It goes into you, doesn't it? So we were placed into the body, and the Spirit was placed into us, right? We're all made to drink of that one Spirit. So, you know, one of the things that's quite remarkable, I think, is that Lewis Sperry Schaefer, in his Systematic Theology, has a list of about 119 things that happened to you the day you got saved. I mean, amazing things happened that day. It's going to take you all eternity to fully understand the implications of what took place on that day. Isn't that amazing? But one thing that happened is you became part of the body of Christ. And you can't become not part of the body of Christ. In fact, you can be put out of the local church. They can put you out of fellowship here. If you're in sin or whatever, they can put you out, but they can never put you out of the body of Christ. You're in it forever. Right? That's secure, right? You're part of the body. You'll always be part of the body. You'll never be unpart of the body. You were placed into the body. And the Spirit was placed into you, and he's not leaving. We're going to see that later on. You're sealed with the Spirit till the day of redemption. He's going nowhere. So he's in you, and he's in you for the long haul. He's not quitting. And you're in the body. He's in you, you're in the body. And that happened on the day that you got saved. The very moment of conversion is when that became a reality to all of us. And of course, that body is the church. There's one body, one Spirit, even as you're called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, all believers placed into that one body. And so that happened to us. We're never commanded in Scripture to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. We're told we are. Again, right here, the language is very clear. For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body. He's not telling them to do it. He's telling them it's happened to them, whether they're Jews or Gentiles, whether they're bond or free. So, again, we said, having begun in the Spirit. That's how we started, right? It all began with the Spirit of God. So here we've got this question. What about passages like Acts chapter 8? Let's look at Acts chapter 8 for a minute. Acts chapter 8 and verses 5 through 17. And so it says, then Philip went down to the city of Samaria and preached Christ to them, and the people with one accord gave heed unto those things which Philip spake, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. For unclean spirits, crying with a loud voice, came out. Many of them were possessed with them, and many taken with palsies that were lame were healed. There was great joy in the city. And so further on, we want to just see that something further takes place. That they all believe Christ. They heard it. They see it. They believe the message. And then we notice... it says, verse 12, but when they believed Philip preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. So they're believers, they're baptized. But then it says, verse 14, now when the apostles which were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent unto them Peter and John, who, when they were come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost. For as yet he was fallen upon none of them, only they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus, then laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Ghost. We'll just stop there. I'm not going to get into Simon. That will be another day. But I want you just to see this. That I've just been saying that on the authority of the 1 Corinthians, that we're baptized into the one body, we're baptized, the baptism of the Spirit occurs the day we're saved. But here, the Samaritans believed and they were baptized, but the apostles had to come from Jerusalem and lay hands upon them before they received the Holy Spirit. And see, again, our Pentecostal brethren would say, right, subsequent to conversion, somebody's got to lay hands on you so you receive the Holy Spirit. The Anglicans and the Catholics. I remember when I was 12 years of age, I went forward for confirmation. The bishop laid his hands on me, and they told me I'd received the Holy Spirit. I was baptized as a baby, further laying on of hands, confirmation. I supposedly got the Holy Spirit. Where do they get it from? Well, they get it from these passages. So what's going on here? Well, remember the Samaritans. How did the Jews think of the Samaritans? Were they in approval of them? What did they think about them? Remember James and John? Those cuddly brothers? The sons of thunder, right? And what they said, shall we call fire down from heaven on these people, right? That's their attitude to the Samaritans. The disciples, when the Lord Jesus is talking to the Samaritan woman, they wondered that he was speaking to her. They should be amazed that he was speaking to them, never mind speaking to her, but they're amazed, right? Because she's a Samaritan and she's a woman. I mean, that's the ultimate, right? That's how they saw things. And so the Samaritans were these kind of, well, they were half-breeds. At the time of the Assyrian captivity, they took the northern tribes, some of them they took into Assyria, and then they brought foreigners in, and then they kind of intermarried between them, and they were part Gentile, part Jew, and they were these half-breeds, and they had a mixed-up theology. They believed part pagan things and part the Word of God. And so the Jews hated the Samaritans. They had no dealings with them. But now we've got this truth of a one body of Jews and Gentiles in one. Now, how are the Jews going to accept this? Well, the Samaritans particularly, if there's this separate movement in Samaria, the danger was that you'd have a Samaritan church developing and you'd have a Jerusalem church developing. But the fact that they laid hands on them means identification. Isn't that what that means when you lay hands on something, you're identifying with them? And the Spirit came upon the apostles laying on of hands, and it's because Acts is this transitional book, and it's a book of massive changes. And so getting people used to what God is doing, he's doing something new, and it was necessary for the apostles to identify with them so the Jews would accept that God was now accepting the Samaritans on equal terms with the Jews. And that's why you have that necessity for this to take place. But the normative practice in the church age is the moment a person believes, he's placed by the Spirit into the one body, and the Spirit is placed in him. But prior to this, in these early days of the transition of the church, it was necessary for this identification that God is doing something new and he's accepting these into the body. So what happened to us through this baptism? We're placed into his body. Individual believers are placed into the living church. We're also placed in union with Christ, because Christ is the head of the body. And now we're in the body, so we're in union with Christ now. He's the head, we're the body. We're identified with Christ. There's this new union of life. And so all those things happened on the day that we were saved. Now, what about the sealing of the Holy Spirit? Now, again, this term is never used in the Old Testament. And so what do we mean when we talk about the sealing of the Spirit? What actually is this particular work? Of the sealing of the Spirit. We say it's never referred to in the Old Testament, but it is referred to in the New Testament. And so let's look, please, First of all, at Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. In a verse that we've looked at before, and that is verse 30. Ephesians 4, verse 30. It says this, "And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed unto the day of redemption." Let's look at another couple of scriptures, please. 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 22. It says, "Who hath also sealed us and given us the earnest of the Spirit in our hearts." Now again, notice he has already done this. "Who hath also sealed us." Grieve not the Spirit where you are sealed. You are sealed until the day of redemption. Ephesians 1 and verse 13, where we read this, it says, "In whom you also trusted after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that you believed, you were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise." So three times in the New Testament, we have this statement that we're sealed with the Spirit of promise. Now, what does that really mean? It's certainly a work that has been done. It's a work that's been done by the Spirit for us, and it's something that happened when we believed. So what is the meaning and the significance of sealing? I want to see how the word sealing is used in Scripture to kind of give us a flavor of what's involved in this idea of being sealed. So let's go back to the book of Jeremiah, the book of Jeremiah chapter 32. Jeremiah 32. Very significant chapter, by the way, in understanding the book of Revelation, as well as other portions of Scripture. But we'll break in verse 9. It says this, "And I bought a field of Hanameel, my uncle's son, that was in Anathoth, and weighed him the money, even 17 shekels of silver, and I subscribed the evidence and sealed it and took witnesses and weighed him the money in the balances. So I took the evidence of the purchase book that was sealed according to the law and custom and that which was open." But we just stop there. That's enough really for... So he buys a field. Now, it's kind of interesting. What is Jeremiah's essential message? What is he preaching? He's preaching, "We're going into Babylon," right? So, and we're going for how long? How long does he say we're going to be there? 70 years. And so he buys a field. Why would you buy a field when you know the Babylonians are going to take over the country? Because he also knows we're coming back, right? And so it's evidence that, yes, we're going into captivity, but we're coming back here. So he buys a field, and when he gets the field, of course, you get the paperwork to say you've bought the field. And so you have he pays the money, and he gets a document, and this document is the title deed to the land that he's purchased, and the proof that it's the real deal is that it's got a seal on it, okay? So if you ever get to the point where you pay off your mortgage, right, you get the title deeds, and usually there'll be the seal of the authority on it, like it used to be a wax seal, and they'd use a ring or whatever, and it means it's a sealed deal. It's yours. It's the official transcript. It's a proof of a finished transaction, and the price is paid in full. Okay, that's the idea. You own it. This is your property. Okay. Now the significance in Revelation is the Lord Jesus goes up to the one who's seated on the throne, and he has a seven sealed document, doesn't he? A scroll. What is that scroll? It's the title deed to planet Earth. Who's worthy to take it? Well, the Lord Jesus. So he has to open the seals to get into the document to say it's his. Okay, so that's the idea. So in terms of the sealing of the Spirit, what does it mean? The very fact that we are sealed with the Holy Spirit means that we've been bought and paid for by the Lord. A finished transaction has occurred. The price has been paid in full, and we now belong to the Lord. Isn't that wonderful? So we're sealed. You're mine. I bought you. I'm coming back to get you. You're mine. Absolutely sealed. That's a good thing. Praise God for that. And so it's a wonderful picture of a finished transaction. John 6, just looking at how the word sealed is used in the New Testament and the Old Testament, so we can get a picture in our minds of what the sealing of the Spirit is about. John 6, verse 27. Yes. Labor not for the meat which perisheth, but for that meat which endureth unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you. For him hath God the Father sealed. In what sense has the Son of Man been sealed by God the Father? Good to ask ourselves these questions, isn't it? Could I suggest to you that there's another way we use the word seal? We use it as a finished transaction, the sealing of a document, but we also use it as a sign of approval. We give them our seal of approval, okay? So you'll see a lot of British produce, and it will say about Her Majesty. Now it's going to be His Majesty, right? But it's saying it's met the approval of royalty. So you should enjoy this cup of tea because it has royal approval. He's set his seal upon it, the king, right? That's the idea. And so isn't it wonderful that not only is the price being paid in full, but God is saying, I set my seal of approval on you. Isn't that nice? To be approved of God, we're sealed. It's like a seal of approval. The divine approval, the seal of divine approval. We were once the enemies of God, but now, because of the work of Christ, we have the seal of divine approval. And then Matthew 27, verse 66. Matthew 27, verse 66. So they went and made the sepulchre sure, sealing the stone and setting a watch. So the tomb, the stone was rolled over it, and then it had Caesar's seal put on it. And so what that was saying is it was really a visible expression of security. This, all the authority of Caesar is behind this securing this. Now, of course, Caesar's authority didn't do much good, did it? It was rolled away. Praise God for that. But what about if you had a seal that was given by somebody much greater than Caesar, like the Spirit of God? Would that give you some security? In other words, to break that seal, you've got to be bigger than God, right? And so not only do we have this finished transaction idea and a divine approval, but it's a visible expression of security. This has all the security of the Spirit of God behind it. That's you. You are secure because you're secure in the Spirit. He secured you. And then one more, please, Revelation 7. And this is the description of the 144,000. And they're sealed, aren't they? Verse 3, saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. And I heard the number of them that were sealed, And there were sealed 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel, of the tribe of Judah were sealed, so on and so forth. We know the story well. And in this case, it was the seal of divine ownership. These men belonged to God. They were his servants. They belonged to him. And they were, nobody could kill them because they belonged to God. They had his seal upon them. And so, again, it's a symbol of being sealed by the Spirit of divine ownership. We now belong to God. So when we get to Ephesians 4, we said that we have the possibility of grieving the Spirit. But then it goes on and says, the very same verse, but we're sealed with the Spirit until the day of redemption. Now, what's that day of redemption? Right? There's three stages of redemption, right? In a sense, we were redeemed the day we were saved by the precious work of Christ. We're being redeemed on an ongoing basis, in a sense, that he continues to, the penalty's being paid, but he continues to accept that. But ultimately, the final aspect of redemption is the redemption of the body, when we're going to be with him and we're going to be like him. And so God is saying, I am going to set the seal of the Spirit on this person. Now, even though you may grieve him, and you may grieve him 1,000 times, he will never leave you because you are sealed until the day of redemption. Now, I don't know about you, but I find it very encouraging to know that I can grieve him, but he'll never leave me. He's with me for the long haul. I'm a long haul project, and so are you. Till our last breath, we're sealed until the day of redemption, when we're caught up to meet the Lord in the air. So again, it's a wonderful thing to know that we're sealed by the Spirit of God. We cannot grieve away the Holy Spirit because he has sealed us until the day of redemption. Well, it's 4 o'clock. We haven't finished the security of the Spirit yet, but we'll come back and do that after our break. Let's pray. Father, we just again are thankful for this finished transaction that has been made. We're thankful, Father, for the security we have by the fact that you have sealed us with the Spirit of God. Thank you that we're in the body, that you've placed us in the body. You've placed your Spirit within us. Lord, all these things that happened that day, that marvelous day, that glorious day when we passed from death to life, when we trusted the Lord Jesus as our personal Savior. Help us to appreciate what we have and who we are in the Lord Jesus Christ. We'll give you the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.